Ngayong gabi sa Reaksyon, 45 taon ang nakakaraan ng matikman ng mga Pilipino ang batas militar sa ilalim ng pamumuno ni dating Pangulong Ferdinand Marcos. At kahit halos 5 dekada na ang nakakaraan, bakas pa rin sa mga nakasaksi sa panahon ng martial law ang malalim na marka na iniwan nito sa ating kasaysayan at demokrasya. Ngayong gabi, babalikan natin ang kasaysayan kasama ang binansagang arkitekto ng batas militar at defense minister noong panahon ng martial law. Good evening po sa inyo and welcome to Reaksyon, Senator Juan Ponce Enrile. Okay, it's interesting, sir, also that I'm talking to you at a time when we're approaching September 21, of course. Yeah. At alam naman po nating lahat na yung nangyari sa inyo, sir, na ambush noong 1972 na sinasabi nilang naging mitsa ng pagdeklara ng martial law.
No, that's not true.
Sir, ito na nga
No, I'm telling you. I'm okay, already sir. Cutting
ano
you
dito,
because
dahil,
that is a falsehood done by Raymond Bonner, who is actually a member of Comintern, of the left. You should read the book of Louis Glick. When he wrote his book, he said that I said that my ambush, supposed ambush, was staged. True, it was staged. By so, some people, I did not know.
Teko na, sir, so totoo palang staged?
Yeah.
Sir, kasi na...
But it was not I who staged it, because what he implied is that I made up my ambush to become a basis for President Marcos to declare martial law. That is not true. At the time the event happened, we were already under martial law. Whether there was an ambush or not, there was martial law was already going on.
Okay, sir. Bago na namang version to.
This is, no, it's okay, a version.
Sir, kasi ganito, di ba?
It is not a version. I was the actor at that time.
No, but during at the height of the EDSA revolution, February 23, you were with Fidel Ramos in Camp Crame.
Yeah.
And you said, you yourself said that the ambush was staged precisely
correct.
To justify
martial law. I never denied that this
and
was...
And then later, when you launched your book, you denied that ambush was faked.
No, I did not deny. I always said that it was staged, but it was not staged by me, which was the implication of people because in reading Bonner.
But did you know then when you were ambushed
that I was
that
going
this
to be ambushed? I'll be foolish.
Were you in the car, sir? When were you in the car
no,
when it?
Because in those days I changed cars every day.
You had no idea that it was going to be done.
I have no idea. My God, why should I do that? What for?
But at that time, sir, did you know that Marcos's hand was behind it?
Who said that it was the hand of Marcos who did it?
Well, because that's
I never said that.
That's what they're saying. It became the basis for the declaration.
Again, that
of
is their conclusion. I do not know.
Well, okay. So nangyari na nga po itong martial law sa ilalim ni Marcos. At ngayon po, ang mga Pilipino ay talagang sensitibo na po pagdating sa usapin ng martial law, no? At hanggang ngayon na si Presidente Duterte mayat maya ay tila baga nagbabanta na baka magdeklara siya ng martial law pag hindi niya makontrol itong maute or kung ano man, no, ang mga protesta.
Ayaw ninyo yun.
Ano po ang...
Ayaw ninyo gamitin ng presidente yung kapangyarihan na ibinigay ninyo sa kanya.
Ang publiko po, in general, napapraning pagdating sa martial law.
Ano?
Ang publiko, napaparanoid pagdating
sa martial
law.
Who is the embodiment of the public to speak for them? How did you know the temper of the people?
Well, they express it in many ways.
We express certitudes that are not true, are fallacious. You know, to tell you the truth, people, even now, feel more secure, according to them, to the people that I talk to, because I travel almost every month from Manila all the way to the north by car. And they feel more secure because we have a president who is enforcing the law.
Do they trust the president more than they trust martial law per se?
No, martial law
there are two entities
martial
here.
Law
you,
is,
you know, if it were another
can,
president declaring martial law,
is
it would have
not self-executing. It is a power that may or may not be exercised by a president if he does not want. But he may be forced by the exigencies of national events in the society to exercise the powers, the ultima ratio, as they call it, available to a government, not to protect himself or his position, but to protect you and the public so that the country will not be damaged and the people will not be injured.
But it could also be abused.
Any power is subject to abuse. There is no such thing. So no power that is not subject to abuse.
So that's
by
why,
different degrees.
Oh, kaya nga sir, kaya ako na itatanong. Sa ilalim ni President Duterte, sa tingin niyo po ba siya ay magiging responsable sa paggamit ng martial law?
You have to trust him. You voted for him to become president. If there's no one else that can exercise that power except only one person, and that is the person who was selected by the people to be their leader. Leader. Not alila, but leader.
Sa tingin niyo po ba, sir, yung ginawa nilang mga pagbabago sa ating saligang batas upang tiyakin na kahit pa may martial law at kailanganing magdeklara ng martial law, meron na ngayong mga safeguards.
Pinahina nila ang estado doon sa saligang batas na kasalukuyan na ginagamit natin at pinalakas nila yung mga manggugulo.
So hindi kayo sang-ayon sa provision ng martial law implementation as it is now?
No. You know, even in Russia they have martial law. Even Iran, they have martial law. America, they have martial law. The governors of every state are invested with the power of martial law. Not the president of the United States. He has the power to drop an atom bomb in Hiroshima or in Nagasaki, but he does not have the power of martial law because martial law is a residuary power given retained by the states through their governor. It is for the survival of the state. That is the purpose of martial law.
So sa tingin nyo nga po, yung mga ginawa nilang, nilagay nilang mga safeguards doon para hindi abusuhin ng sino mang pangulo ang kapangyarihan niya na magdeklara ng martial law, sinasabi nyo, nakapagpahina pa yun.
Nakapagpahina sa estado.
Ano po ang maaaring mangyari?
Nagkaroon ng rioting dito sa Maynila kung magkakaroon ng problema tayo. Let's say, God forbids that something happens to the arteries of commerce on both sides, south and north of Manila. And you do not supply your food here in Metro Manila. And you have riotings. What are you going to use to quell the disorder? Prayer?
Hindi naman siya, pwede naman siya bigyan ng martial law powers, limitado nga lang. Hindi ba tama yun?
At that point, in a situation like that I have in my mind, I conjure in my mind, that you have no time to be talking about writ of habeas corpus, bail, or anything. You have to use the army and the police in order to maintain, order to reduce, if you can reduce, the number of casualties.
Do you really think that it takes an authoritarian leadership to actually rein in?
This is not an authoritarian government. It's not an authoritarian power. It is the power of the state in any society for survival.
But people are saying, for example, na all around the globe and not just here, no? Parang umuusbong na naman, sir, yung mga sinasabi nilang strong men, no? President Duterte, strong.
Because we have been used to pacifism. You know, there was a time when people like Frederick the Great or Peter the Great of Russia or
even
Napoleon
Japan
Bonaparte
became pacifist after World War II.
Oh.
So what's wrong with that?
That is the evolution of every era. If you study history, you see these types of leaders.
But people are saying na yung mga Pilipino raw para talagang tumino.
I'll give you a classic example. You have two types of leaders, Neville Chamberlain and Adolf Hitler. Chamberlain was a pacifist. He brought about World War II because he showed his pacifism to a strong-willed human being. An admirer of Hitler. I am talking about history and about the character of leaders that come about in the course of time in the life of humankind. Let's zero into our present era in this country. We have a president. He's using the Constitution to solve problems. Can you say that he has gone out of the Constitution? Can anybody say, oh, Duterte has gone out of the Constitution? Then if so, why not?
People are saying he has.
Why not impeach him?
EJK and
People who are people. My God, that is the trouble with the with this kind of system where people assume privilege of speaking for quote the people, unquote.
Alam niyo naman po siguro that there's now an electoral protest that Bongbong Marcos has filed, no? How do you feel about the Marcoses going back to power and not just as a congressman or a senator, but really, once he becomes vice president, if he succeeds in this electoral dispute?
You know, it is not you, it is not for you, for me, or for anyone else to say who should be back in power or not. It is a function of the people.
That's right.
And it is
I agree with you, sir. What I wanted
function,
to ask you.
It is a function of the constitution that you have adapted.
Yes,
it's
sir.
A function of the society.
Absolutely, sir.
God, if the people want them to be in power, then who are we to say no?
What does it say about
who
the history?
Writing? Who are writing about it? Is there anybody who has written the history of the Marcos years? I do not know of anybody.
Some people have accused other people of revising history. That the history that we are seeing now or reading now is a revisionist history.
What is the history?
Where martial law was actually
history is
the 20-year dictatorship of Marcos, as opposed to what was taught to those
people that encountered in my readings of history, where they want to portray what they believe to portray and put aside the things that they do not want. No, it is not like that, you know. Who brought the democratization of education in this country? Noynoy Aquino? Cory Aquino? Who brought the irrigation canals all over the country? Who brought the rural electrification in this country? Have they written about these things? Who destroyed the nuclear plant? And who initiated it in order to stabilize the power system of the country, especially when we do not have a source of crude to maintain our lights and our industries and our convenient life in this society?
So ultimately, the question is, who's revising which history?
I'm not revising. I want answers to these questions that I'm raising. I have a right to raise these questions. That's why people do not want to meet me in a face-to-face intellectual combat like this, because I ask them questions that they could not answer.
Wow, sir.
Come on.
You know, 51 years of political life and what, 8 presidencies. Who am I to debate with you?
I'm not saying that I know everything, but when I deal with a problem, even during martial law, I go into it and learn it deeply in order to be able to handle the situation.
We did see that, sir. Yeah. We saw that very clearly during the impeachment trial where you presided over the trial of SC Corona. And sir, lahat bumilib talaga sa utak ninyo doon. We know, sir, that this is coming from years and years of political practice and political thinking and deep insight.
It's
we are honored that you are here with us.
I hope you don't mind. You did not mind my debating with
you.
Oh,
not at all, sir.
Because sometimes
I am honored that somebody like you would debate with me. Who am I to debate with you? Maraming salamat po ulit sa inyo, Senator Edrile.
Welcome.
Have a good evening.
Anytime.
Kung wala magsasabi, wala mangyayari, ang opinion mo, pinakikinggan, pinag-uusapan, dahil ang bawat balita, may katumbas na reaksyon. Ako po si Luchi